First of all, I would like to wish everyone my greetings. And then I will continue from yesterday. We completed the topic of the completion the creation phase meditation. And so today we will have a short teaching on the completion phase. And so first I will read from the instructions themselves.
Pardon, Major, but Nanke, Lambos, Yonado, Tamar Chicker Yon, Ne Zintuan, Chapo, the Yamso Lango, Te Tambone, Gagarna, Ragorke, you do what the Chinagi, Yukana, and Migo, Medeba, Midengu, Jenki, Semi, Tudurbon, Dile, Kam, Micho, or Shabe, Sibatan, the Bechet, and Rushing. Ting and Soye, Michaber Shabe, Nangal, La, Satorwa. Chapa Mabashin Jung. Dead the Bombash in a chunky song at the J. Tabolaji Luigi Zizig Tobasai. Never ne Lambuji Gong Zudi, put you to you, Mambu Migubada. Shiba Kona Palmebashi, Tamburu, Udo, the Shigishi. And then in Zinugi Loye, then a canado loan, a shaggy rida, Teddy, the Shiba Tutu to Mason, shaking the Major, looks among Simbi. Duba Chevashin. So in Yamshin Jung, a day to Shevashi Zess were the Bugona Gombaino. Sumba, Chigger Jongane, Yazuchin with Zinguane, Chapel, the Surlom, and Toba Migubashin. Sim, Dingins in a Zessit Navy, Nanjo Batala, Didudan, Nyamogot of Jinraji, Gayam, T. Chim, Toba Migudi, Chigi, Tosun Kang Gavan, T. Tinim with Tigrisimba, Chidogi. Chenshi Jube, Dinginzilla, Cham Cham Drawashi Wong, Tere Cham Cham Songatang, Kuyang Ding Ding Gyongi, Tere Songan, Yusin Gomber Chao.
There are three focuses for the main practice of Mahamudra. At first, resting undistracted like a person spinning a sword as they enter a battle. In the middle, being skilled at the key point of remaining without altering, like an elephant herder, and in the end, practicing the key point of sustaining at will, like a bird flying off a ship. For the first, just like an Indian sword spinner entering a battle, rest without focusing on any outer or inner object, not deviating at all from this keenly aware mind that can think of anything. By doing so, all cognitions will be completely severed. Rest in the nature of that without changing it at all, and it will not get stuck on anything, like throwing soil into the sky. When it becomes serene just like that, this is what is called the realization of one-pointedness in Gampopa's tradition. For the second, just as a herdsman tending elephants does not need to rush about much, the mind itself, like spinning wools, first falls apart upon the object, and then any cognition of capable of apprehension disappears. Next, turn inwards, and without the mind becoming exhausted as if it were a deer hounded by hunting dogs, merely relax without adjusting anything out of any wish. Prolonging this state brings an experience like becoming exhausted after running. At that time, meditate like a strong man conserving his energy. For the third, sustaining at will. When a bird flies off a ship in the middle of a great ocean, there is no need to worry that it will not return. Likewise, no matter what thought of pleasure, pain, or the afflictions arises, yogis whose minds rest one-pointedly in samadhi have no need to worry that it will bind them. Whatever arises, whether the eight concerns or three poisons, is entirely caught when it arises, and applying the mindfulness and awareness that blocks it makes it subside tranquilly into samadhi. As that becomes more and more tranquil, sustain it broadly and deeply. When it becomes like this, prolong it and meditate on it.
Tene kānāng gēzhūr dāng rūwī nēzhī xie gui dē. Dīdū dāng chāgdāng dā yū yī dō hūng mō sō. Jīn dā shī tōng tū tēng kiā rōng. Tē dā nām jī yīng kiā rōng. Jī gā wā rā kī yī nyā bē. Tēng bē sū nē xī xī nām mā rī sēn dēb dāng, nyām lēn dāng, ngō wā dāng, sūn bū tē lā. Ā nā pūr chū kā rā tōng gui bā yīng. Tē zā nā tī nyē rā dāng, lā mā dāng. Chunjimgi korwada nyuruwa so mugyo bashi unwa yin jengi jichungya chosu kershe goba yin.
Next, you must know the key point for whatever appears becoming spiritual practice. Whatever pleasure or pain, greed or hatred, pleasant or unpleasant object, and so forth you see, hear, or think of, no matter what it may be, apprehend it with the mindfulness of thinking, let it do what it wants. Then you must devote yourself to supplications, practice, and dedications to have genuine awareness. When that happens, you will no longer need to be surrounded or patrolled by instructors, gurus, or discipline masters. No matter what adversity occurs, you must know how to take it as an aid.
That is really easy. 가장 권도 쉬운 신기 낸줄 주기 거디 주의 윤기 낸줄 주세야 돼 버지디 용디 유스레
Now following this there is the passage on the six yogas the six yogas from the tradition of the river current
다디 세기 낸줄 아니 괴기 낸줄 내강기 두배기 내 내강기 낸줄 니기 낸줄 디 다디 시부디 튠섬기 균기 다 간다 균두 튠섬리야 다 진냠레 차기 낸줄 디 임브레 다디네 디 띵두 포아당 파르드 낸줄스 포화세랑 포화자 포화조바 포화다 파르드네조 데 첸다 돔네 에 간다 네조 초예비브레 데 네조 초팀 레아 안 초유 균기 네조로 체 숭고아레 두바디 포화당 디 파르도 파르도 네조 데 찍도 집임자
Now following this comes the sections on the yogas, and these six yogas are these yogas of eating, the yoga of clothing, the yoga of your residence, the place where you're staying, and the yoga of sleep. These four yogas are the yogas that we do in the breaks between sessions. They're the yoga that we need to practice continually. Then in addition to these, there are the yogas for poa and the bardo. So these two yogas are combined into a single yoga here. So these are the six yogas in the tradition of the river current.
The tradition of river flows in Kensa Chandma. True Gyundu Nyamlen Shiak Nenjo Reyes Lapshantu.
So the meaning of the tradition of the river current is that it is yogas that we need to do continually, like the current of a river. So one could maybe translate it as the continual flow. Now in these instructions by Mikyo Dorje, not all six of these yogas are clearly present. It doesn't seem that they're necessarily all here. There is a section on sleep. There is also a section on Poa and the Bardo, and it seems there's also a bit about the yoga of the residents. But it's not, it doesn't clearly instruct each of the six. No matter what physical illnesses or mental sufferings, or to sum it up, anything undesired occurs, what apprehends at all of them is your own mind. Thus you must develop a genuine experience of the mind itself not being inherently established. When that arises, you should rouse the energy of diligence and meditate. Thus at times, whenever the eight concerns make you uncomfortable, and whenever any conditions that conflict with Dharma, such as the afflictions, arise, you need such a practical application of the Dharma, just as you need some felt when it rains and snows. Now here in discussing the yogas of the completion phase, it's as I mentioned yesterday. Primarily here, the completion phase is emphasizing the practices of Mahamudra. So the completion phase here is primarily Mahamudra. Now actually, I don't really know how to say too much about the topic of Mahamudra. And actually, even before you begin the practices of Mahamudra, you actually need to first do the preliminary practices. You first need to do the preliminary practices in order to make your being an appropriate vessel that can hold, that can contain the Dharma. And without doing this, then you can't just immediately do the Mahamudra practice. It's not as if you can just do it right away. Now, as I mentioned yesterday, for Mahamudra, there are two types of Mahamudra. There is the Sutra tradition Mahamudra and the Mantra tradition Mahamudra. Now, whether there is a distinction between the two is a topic that many different scholars in the Kagyu tradition have described in different ways. There are some who say that in terms of the essence, there is no distinction between the two. There are others who say that there is a distinction between the two. And so in this manner, there are various different explanations of how it is. Now, as we generally say, as is generally known, when the great Lord of Dakpo Gampopa taught Mahamudra, he primarily taught Mahamudra based on the King of Samadhi Sutra. And so this is how the sutra tradition Mahamudra arose. Then later, when the Gyalwnag Karmapa Mikyo Dorje spoke about Mahamudra, he said that primarily most instructions on Mahamudra are sutra tradition Mahamudra, and that this is actually the same as the unelaborated middle way taught in such texts as the Chariot of the Siddhas of the Dakpo lineage, his text on the middle way. He said that these two things are actually synonymous and the same in meaning. And so for that reason, if we're actually going to practice this Mahamudra, it's not necessary for us to have an empowerment before we do the practice, because it is in the sutra tradition. If, on the other hand, we are practicing mantra tradition Mahamudra, then it does need to be preceded by an empowerment. And so for that reason, he says that generally, with the Mahamudra instructions that we usually follow, these are most likely in the sutra tradition. Now, in the when we do the meditation, there are three things that we must not alter. These three things are that we must have an unaltered body, an unaltered speech, and an unaltered mind. And so the unaltered body means that we are sitting in the seven-point posture of Vairochana. That means that we're sitting in the meditation posture with the 7 points.
Yeah, la sum, yuan la sum, anu yu la sum zar, deg,
The unaltered speech here probably means that you expel the stale breath. You expel it three times through the left, three times through the right, three times through the left, and then three times through the center. And then you just let it be. The unaltered mind means letting the mind be in equipoise. This means that you don't follow thoughts of the past, you don't anticipate the future. So this means that not following the past or anticipating the future, this means that you are sort of separating yourself or isolating yourself from thoughts of the past, of the future, and then just rest in equipoise, letting your mind be.
Tadi kerjulah tu si gongki, dah kerjulah rambut tu sum yang tu sana, tadi rambut tengah bodi main ber, yang bersahadi ber.
And so here it says, first resting undistracted like a person spinning a sword as they enter battle. And so there are three stages of meditation given here, and the first is primarily resting undistracted.
Telayang. Jagaragi chuzi sarahe gumju duzam meva la yinsu kiji mide ba chaga chimbu gomba yinsu tati tunda de kare sara ani je chaga chimbu gomse ne gomyan gumju du mise ga yo maras chungse ga yo maras goms labare ma de gumju mise ji kajwe cheme dreba chen suzuki on didan didabu yin nyabe gone namdo jeju chen
And so this is as the great Indian master Sarahas said, when we meditate on Mahamudra, we're not meditating, but we're also not meditating. We rest one-pointedly and relax. And so what this means, that we rest without meditating, this means that we aren't making up something that we're going to meditate. We don't have some thought, I'm meditating upon this, and particularly meditate on any particular thing. But when we say that there's nothing we're meditating upon, then if we just go about like our usual selves, and then it's as if we're not meditating. So instead of that, we also need to have we need to post the century of mindfulness. We need to apply our mindfulness so that we are not distracted for even an instant. And so one aspect is that we don't have any particular thought that we have that we meditate upon. Instead, we just let our minds relax. The other aspect is that we don't let our minds get distracted, and instead we have the century of mindfulness. And so that is the meditation of mindfulness. So the point is that we are resting one-pointedly without being distracted and letting our minds relax. Now, when we have such an undistracted mindfulness, then whatever thought arises, we recognize it. Whatever situation occurs, we understand. We know the situation. It's not as if we're not meditating, not doing anything, becoming blank and indifferent. That's not the sort of state. It's not like when you don't, not as if you're just resting, not meditating, and becoming blank and unknowing. Instead, our minds are brilliantly clear. They're very vivid, vivid and clear. So when we're in that state, whatever movement of thought there is, then we just recognize it. We know it, and it's important to be able to rest in that one-pointedly. For example, if a thought of hatred arises. When that thought of hatred arises, then we catch it with our mindfulness. We know what it is. And then with that thought of hatred, we don't particularly need to think, okay, is this something I need to accept? Is it something I need to reject? We don't have the thought, I need to reject or block my anger. Instead, we just look directly, we rest in meditation directly on that thought of hatred itself without being distracted. And as we rest undistracted upon that thought of hatred itself, then naturally the power of that hatred will decrease. It's as if the hatred becomes a little bit ashamed and then disappears. So it's like this with all of the afflictions. All of the afflictions are actually misapprehensions. They're all wrong thoughts. And so when we rest one-pointedly and undistracted upon them, then it's as if they get a little bit ashamed and naturally disappear. And so that's what this means here.
다디 조디 에 가르지 시바 네 지금 에 가르 에 시바 마이나 삼베 자와자 인기 토바 미제 바체네 시바 아 쓰이 르네 냠버샤 드리지마
The second stage is in the middle, being skilled at the key point of remaining without altering, like an elephant herder. And so this is primarily when we, with our mind, not having the hope that we're going to be undistracted or the fear that we will get distracted, and instead just relaxing and resting in equipoise.
That is what Yun Sung is saying. Shiba Hajan Dim Chapa Mahimba. Yang Shiba Hajan Hu Chapa Mahimba.
And so this is as we usually say, we must not be too tight with our minds, nor should we be too loose. And so we need to have the right amount of tension, the proper amount of tension in our minds. And so whatever thought occurs, we just need to recognize it. And saying we need to recognize the thoughts, as it says in these instructions, it says here, next turn inwards, and without the mind becoming exhausted, as if a deer hounded by a hunting dog. Without the mind becoming exhausted, as if hounding deer like a hunting dog. It's not like we need to have thought arises and then we chased after that thought. I need to get that. I need to find out what that thought is, and I need to recognize that thought. We don't need to be so insistent about it. Instead, what we need to do is to merely relax without adjusting anything out of any wish. So we just need to relax normally without trying to adjust anything. And then when we're in that state, we just need to prolong this experience. And so this is primarily resting without altering anything.
Daddy, shebochi zal suo de wo song duo. Daddy, you say mi xishu qianbu xishu chunjun ji na da gu shu xi wo ji da wo chuo. Mi xishu chunjun ji da ji ga shuo ji ge mini ga shuo mini pa zu da ge lao da.
And
Namdo,
so it's like, as it says here, meditate like a strong man conserving his energy. So it's like, you know, if you're really, you know, if you don't have a lot of strength, if you're not very strong, then, you know, you have to use all of your strength. For example, if you have two people who are wrestling and trying to throw each other to the ground, like a contest of strength, you know, they're wrestling, one's trying to throw the other to the ground. So if one of the people is just not all that strong, that person has to use all of their strength and all their power to try to throw the other to the ground. And, you know, if they don't use it, they'll get, they won't be able to throw the other to the ground. But if someone's really strong, a really powerful person, then they don't really need to do much. They just sort of use a little bit. It's easy for them. They can easily throw the person they're wrestling with down to the ground. And so it's the same thing here. When we are resting in equipoise, not altering anything, and resting naturally, we just continue in that, then we don't need to use all our strength. We don't. We just recognize the thoughts, and then we just naturally have some control, and we just can prolong that. And so it's like that strong man who has all that strength. He just naturally is in control, naturally has the power. He just needs to conserve conserve his power and make it last a long time. But if you're weak, the weak person has to use all their strength at first, and then once they've used it all up, then they don't have anything left. We should not be like that. Instead, so that means that when we're resting in meditation, when a thought arises, we just recognize it, and then we rest naturally and clearly in equipoise. We don't at that point need to follow it and see, oh, can I recognize this thought? Can I catch it? Can I recognize that thought? That is not necessary. The third stage is practicing the key point of sustaining at will, like a bird flying off a ship. And so this is like the example given by the great Brahmin Saraha. Just as a bird that flies off a ship will circle and circle and then land there again. So here are the examples. If you have a boat or a ship, so it's a large ship, and if it goes into the center of the ocean. Now sometimes on ships they would carry birds, and if you have let the bird go from the ship, the bird will fly off from the ship. But the ocean is huge. There's no place for the bird to land, and so eventually the bird will return and land on the ship. And so the meditation here is said to be similar to this analogy.
Sem
And so as we described before, when the mind is able to rest one pointedly in samadhi, you have a you can relax in this, and you have a yogi who is able to practice in this way, then whatever thought it is that arises, there is no fear that it will bind them. There is no fear that it will have any effect of them. They don't need to have any fear. They don't need to have any hopes or fears about their meditation. So whatever arises, whether it be the eight worldly concerns or an affliction, one of the three poisons, whatever occurs, then they just catch it immediately, and then they apply their mindfulness and awareness. And by doing so, then it immediately becomes their samadhi. And here it's said that there are three different methods for resting. There's staying within motion, and then there's staying on the objects. And so when we rest with our mind one-pointedly, then we with our minds undistracted, then we can just rest right within that one-pointedly. That's resting within the mind that's staying. And sometimes there are thoughts that happen. There are many different thoughts that arise and happen. There are various different thoughts. And when they happen, then you just rest on the thought. Sometimes there's like the object. You have the object. Like if you see the empty nature, you see it. You just rest right on that. You don't. And then if that object changes and you think about something else, then you don't. Then you rest right on that object. You don't have any great hope that you have to keep your focus on that previous one. So you have something that you're a support or a focus for your meditation, And if that changes, you don't have to think, oh, I need to go back to the old one. Instead, you can keep on the remain on the new support or focus of that, as long as you are able to remain keep maintain your mindfulness and awareness. It's not like you always have to stay at the, on the same focus or object of your meditation one-pointedly. The point is that you're able to maintain your one-pointed focus with mindfulness and awareness. And so if the object of that one-pointed awareness changes, then that's not not a problem. It's okay as long as you're able to maintain the continuum of mindfulness and awareness.
Yang mungkin tu je tiada, lebih sesiaga juga semua tu. Tadi masih ada juga tu, masih ada juga tu.
And so this is a brief teaching on the methods of resting in shamatha meditation. Now here for the methods of resting in equipoise on insight meditation. They're not explicitly described in the instructions by Mikyo Dorje. And since they're not described here, I think it's okay not to speak about them now. And so next I will talk about the six yogas of the continual flow, but first I will read from the instruction text itself.
Shaye kando walgi gomne semje tamje tuji chamur gomde teba tung tung wari gomge wei ni gi ne jorla ni do jogar changbu du namka ngo ta ngo ta la sem de de mi do bar shan ne war chao chi we chan tebe sem ge che de te arang gi tangbur kan la ne jor do chawa de chigar ya de la che ge be jur pa ba che re zo wo ju sal de de te ning gar Rangi ningar semgi ngo, wegi kumbu karbushila, yigi chuma jasel gitibadabushi, migdi. Di jasal sadi, jage nalola, chusha sadi imita, ache, yaya. Chumdendi gishene, omane bime o shesumbi genshene, rangsimgi kumbu yigi chuma da zeba, pabe kumpando kuba, gomba yino.
So it says, no matter where you go, meditate clearly that the world is a palace and all sentient beings are the great compassionate one. You must meditate with ardent faith. For the yoga of sleep, when you are falling asleep, focus on a clear blue space at your fontanelle, rest in non-thought, and sleep. At the time of death, it is important to feel faith. When you are dying, you should practice whatever you first practiced as your yoga. So visualize Noble Avalokiteshvara above your crown. Focus on a white sphere of light, the essence of your mind, on which the six syllables are written as if in vermilion. Meditate that the Bhagavan saying Om Mani Padme Hum provides the condition for the sphere that is your mind and the six syllables to achieve the state of the noble being.
And
so after completing the practice of the completion phase, then you need to conclude with the dedications and aspirations. Whatever practice you're doing, you need to conclude with the dedications and aspirations. So as I described yesterday, first you start with the creation phase practice, and when you can practice that well and it is stable, then you begin the completion phase practice. Then whatever phase you're doing, whether the creation or the completion phase, you begin with refuge and bodhicitta, and you conclude with the meditation, dedications and aspirations. And following that, you engage in the six yogas of the continual flow, which are the practice for between sessions.
Da susu saagi da sedi ji lai duji imba gom da dile ya yigisum oma hum yigisum chingila ya tane da rani harse rani harse yebche ene jula lama yebche te ma se rangi lugi nangi ji simbudizu bacteria soma da de bacteria isra Symbolism in there, last ever check. They must be two gizms in time to get last ever check. Then take a tone and Garuji, Samolia, G. Shazek, Duzi, Chabapua, Chabapim, Mabache, Chabapua, Latene, and Tamji be two, Beji, Nien, be two Gabachone, two Gabachum Latene, Daji, Tozo, Mabacha. That is second and judicial.
The first of the six yogas of the continual flow is the yoga of meals or food. And so how do we practice this? Well, first of all, you visualize yourself as the body of the deity of Avalokiteshvara. Then you visualize above the crown of your head, you visualize your guru. You imagine that that your food becomes divine amrita nectar. You bless it with the three syllables, Om, Ah, and Hum. So you're visualizing yourself as the deity, you're visualizing the guru above the crown of your head. You also visualize that all of the parasites and all of the bacteria within your body are also become the body of the deity. And so as you you visualize that all of the inhabitants of the universe, all sentient beings, also are the deity. And as you, and then you imagine that you are offering them, all of them, the food and the amrita nectar. As they receive it, they are all pleased and delighted and all very satisfied.
That lama nye tsimbu be karasun sana. Deleya. Tangwan din rabo chi mathe konglas. Tangwan din rabo chi matho konglaya. Se sase tamji. Chesom, Tundu Zasawa, the Kevayo Maris, Anzu, Kalas, Sata Samuel, Chesong Zasawa, Tundu Zasawa, the Kevayo Maris. Dangwan did the Vichi Top Chinjelia. Say, Kandiji serving in that, the server Zungi, Suni Yonsu Zobe, that Govachambo Yerso. The Industanata, Dedigi, Kasuradaji, the Gongue, Gosit Demar.
What Lama Nyen Tsimpupa said is, before we receive these instructions, then no matter what we eat, it's no different than an animal eating. So whatever food we have, it's just like a brute or an animal eating.
But animal, once animal eating grass.
Like an animal eating grass. After we have received these instructions, then just merely eating has the purpose of bringing us to perfect the two kayas. And so here he is teaching the purpose of this meditation.
Lusu
And this is especially important for the Sangha. So this is like we have the tradition of always making an offering whenever we have tea or food. We always make the offering. And the great masters of the past that we say that we do this in order to avoid getting any of the obscurations from eating the what in Tibetan is called the quarter. This means the offerings to the Sangha. And so we first imagine that we're making an offering to the lamas and the three jewels, and by doing this, this will be able to purify any of the obscurations of eating the offerings. Now, actually, we all use this word in Tibetan frequently, the word korda, or offerings to the sangha. And in general, actually, the Tibetan word itself really means all wealth. But here, in particular, it means the material things that the ordained members of the sangha use or enjoy. And so, there's what is said to be the great danger of having the obscurations from these offerings. The reason for this is that all of these offerings are given by sponsors who have great faith in the Sangha, and they have belief in the Sangha. And so we have to give them something to believe in. If they don't have something to believe in, then there's the danger that we ourselves will have the obscurations that come from it. It is said to be a grave misdeed. And so that is why we always talk about these dangers of the offerings to the Sangha. It's said that if you are someone who...
주름 되면 좋아도 좋아서 두 사람 더 버 유리게 남부를 liberate 섬으로 다 어 맞아 어 좋아 남주 가르다 참 좋아서 so
it's said that if you are someone who is who either has discipline or liberation you can use these offerings but otherwise if you use these offerings then you will accumulate a karmic debt. It'll be like an unfinished karmic business and a karmic debt. And so usually it's difficult for us to achieve liberation. That means that you have to have developed realization within your being. But if you keep discipline, even if you only keep one of the vows, if you're someone who keeps only one of the vows and then you accept and use the offerings to the Sangha, then it's okay. It's not so bad. Otherwise, there is a great difficult, great. Otherwise, it could be great, great offense to do so. And so, this is why whenever we have, this is why we always recite the tea offerings or the food offerings. It's in order to avoid the obscurations of accepting the offerings. We may not have the power to avoid this ourselves, but if we make the offering to the gurus and to the three jewels, then by their power, it's able to purify that. And what if and what this shows is it's a sign that we have great faith and confidence in karmic cause and effect.
다들 니바디 고기 내줘래 다 고기 내줘도 직벌해셔 다 공시에 보내시 다 둘러지 둘러싸버지 충분히네 드려보자 미세 둘러싸버지 나는 미 둘러 그뒤 그냥 죽으면 좋아 라버도 지금 둘러싸버지 겸비입니다 다들 지금 라이 그연로지 인상버지 몇 번째지 신기럽네 다 Omahos Lamna Dugmenota, or Omahos Lamda Chingi Lamne, Ya Tangi Kondishavan Singi, Rangi Larseva Tanta, Jiggy, Jiggy, Simulam Larseva Lea, and Chibambi, Mevache, Dirisha. That is somebody near or near hung dangerous. That Rangi Susuig Nan Yavi Nandra, Yana Mishinda Nan Yavi Nandra. Yanaji young Kamba media with the jiggy, jiggy, young Saturn the jelly nevi nanda. That is the homology, Kashre, Shaykan, Shaykan, Jilkuzon, and Mavachan. They are Dutch Chevapin, some of the Dutch, ya, Father Lamalia, Chevapin, the day of Tony, Tots of Chesney, Mavachan, Simita.
The second of the yogas is the yoga of clothing. And so whenever we get clothing, and especially when we get new clothes, but it can be whatever we wear regularly, but especially when we get new clothing, we imagine that when we put it on, that we're dressing the body of the deity. We first bless the clothes by saying Om Ah Om, and then we visualize ourselves as the deity, we visualize all sentient beings as the deity, and imagine that we're offering the clothing. The third of the six yogas of continual flow is the yoga of the residence, and here you visualize wherever you're staying, whether it be your own home, someone else's home, or if you're sleeping out in the open, outside of a home, you imagine wherever that you may be as being that it all becomes a palace. And then you make, then you offer that palace to the gurus and to the gurus and to the deities, and so this is perfects the accumulations of perfects the accumulations.
That is Shiva di thagi kondonge jishu karcha de nejur chogi changa jishu imba. Dada chungse mendo dada di shamar kunja yela ti nalola Shiva di rawa korwe nejur sunga. 당기 공동에 시바디 니기 내주 쉬임바 이내 장마 구조 연락이 티 나라라 시바 꼬르웨 난주로소 꼬르웨 내주 사디 서그만블레스 멜레션 드지브라 수수 예쇼알리아 지 가르쇼다 지 제레스기 가르쇼다 줌부치 야마나 지 셴메카 야나 최대 드르지 예비치 디위레야 바바투지 셴보 타조 코르드지 슈예비 메바체 엔 델레야 고와치비 메바체 단도나 지 가르로 조아 탐지 인지 민지 가르로 꼬라 자간 르두스다네 곰바치 곰바치 꼬라 자과 최대로 꼬라 자과 개요 마레스 디디수수 삼로 땅투나 남균 드가스 로데비나 데 꼬라 쳐요레스 디디수이브다
Now the fourth of the six yogas is the yoga of circumambulating. Now actually this is a slightly different way of listing them than I mentioned before. But what it says in the instructions by the sixth Shamar Kunjo Yenlak, it says that this is the it says the that the instruction of circumambulating. And so it the other one it said sleep, but here it says circumambulating. So this means that no matter where it is, wherever you go, you imagine that you are circumambulating, that to your right side there is Avalokiteshvara. You imagine that to your right side there's either palace or a stupa or whatever, and in the center of that there is the great compassionate one surrounded by his entire retinue of deities. And as you go, with each step, you imagine that you are circumambulating him. And so in this way, each step that you take becomes circumambulating, and for this reason, there is no longer any need to necessarily go to a stupa or to a temple to circumambulate. Even your normal going about your business becomes circumambulation.
나바디 샤머꾸조 연락이 티나로라 니기네 주송입니다.
In the instructions by the Shamarkunchu Yenlak, the fifth is the yoga of sleep.
나들이야 지기 그 냠슬랜다로 넘버 2스레 지기들이야 정이 이름도 세면바체 콘슈 주변에서 이런 이름도 써야 돼. 디지오레야 라마군두기 가장 주변에서 라마군두기 라마지 걸었다. 라마군두기 세탑. 다들 수수기 라마군두기 세탑는 랑게 닝가다 가르래. 랑게 닝가 주다. 아니 뭐 닝가디 닝게게 따자 우마디 바 데니게 되지 가르 저버시는 게 되지 근데 삼타이 주사네 닝글레야 아니 가장 이시셈 바 처음 가와서야지 여러바 이시셈 바 처음 가와들지 검체 다 대래 외설주 이시셈 바 처음 가와디게 두가네 외설주에네 외설디 야르포네 그 가르주로잖아 닝게게 자다 지주게 자데 데니에 베 인주사 디버로 자 우마 데니에 베 인주사네 다디기 이시스마촌 강화될 외스르야 띵기 라말라포 라말라포바들 데네 라마디 지주리에베다 라마디 지중도 신 타 대본점도 교는 봐 집중 다 집중도 충중을 줘 다 집중점도 교네스 다 대본점도 교네스 람드금도 다 대본점도 교네 에너마 중 지금 팁 다들 마 저 우만의 균이 말 전에 아니 닝게기 이시스 바디기 지울라 르다 수도 쇼유에 삼에 매바 잡고 있어. 다 이제 전에 매바 전에 아니 남도 남도 마제 전에 다 이게 튜인 루지와 니 거면 그 튜인 루와 되네 당부 대미 바데 다 이제 거네 튜인 줄래야
Now, there are two different methods for practicing the yoga of sleep. The first is that, as I described before, you visualize yourself as the Adam deity, and then above your crown, you visualize the gurus. But this is the union of all the gurus. You visualize the union above the gurus above your head. In your heart, you visualize the wisdom being, who, as I mentioned yesterday, is a finger in length, or finger length in height. And so you have the guru above your crown of your head and the guru in your heart. And in between the two places, there is the central channel that goes directly between the two. So you have from the wisdom being inside your heart, you imagine that light radiates. And this light radiates and goes up the central channel, because the central channel connects the two, as the central channel goes from your crown to your heart. It goes directly up the central channel, and it strikes the guru above the crown of your head. And as it strikes the guru above your head, the guru above your head gets smaller and smaller until the guru becomes the size of your thumb. And then when he becomes that size, and he comes down, and he then sits above the crown of the wisdom deity in your heart center as the lord of the family. And so you imagine this, and then you try not to have any other thoughts. And so this is the session that you do when you're going to bed. You first do this visualization, you hold the visualization, and then at the end you relax into emptiness and you rest. And while resting in emptiness, you go to sleep. And so this is the session of yoga to practice when you go to sleep. And so the way you do this yoga is that you first sit on your bed on top of your blankets. You sit there and you go through this, after you've done everything else, you don't have anything left to do, you sit on your blankets and you go through the stages of the visualization as the deity and so forth. And then you do the whole session, and at the end you rest in emptiness, relax your mind, not thinking of anything else. And then without doing anything else, you lie down and go to bed. That's how you should do this session. Otherwise, it's kind of strange. If you lie down and try to do this practice while lying down, then Avalokiteshvara is sitting, you know, in the meditation posture, and it's cross-legged, and you're lying down, and that's just kind of strange. It's not so comfortable.
Tongba rupchik, dindijiliyaba, sem tene. Anu chik, mi se ki, ta chik, pena chik, nima chik nalol, ta lega mangu shivu chene, en ta kanta namdo mangu shivu chorba. Ta digi di namdo digi di pana tongba sem rup te chik, namdo digi di pa sang ni. Anu kaya mbe, chik karchwe, Then
the other one is as mentioned here in the instructions by Mikyo Dorje for the yoga of sleep. When you're falling asleep, focus on a clear blue space at your fontanelle, rest in non-thought and sleep. And so here, space, this means like an empty space above the fontanelle or the crown of your head. And this is like meditating on emptiness. So you focus your mind on an empty space above the crown of your head. And then, without many thoughts or many things to do, you focus on this space, and then the thoughts all dissipate. And so you rest within this, and so it's the fontanelle that is above the crown at the union of the juncture of the bones and the skull. It's the fontanelle. And so you rest in non-thought, meditating a bit on emptiness, and then if you lie down, it's fine. And so practicing in this method is also okay. And so Lama Nyen Senpupa himself said is that before we receive this instruction, we spend half of our lives no different from animals. That means that it's basically pointless, our lives. But once we have achieved, or once we've received this instruction, then even our sleep becomes a way to perfect the two accumulations. And the reason for this is, as often said, if at the time of sleeping, if your mind is imbued with a virtuous thought, then the sleep also becomes virtue. If your mind is infected with an unvirtuous thought, then the sleep becomes unvirtuous, as this is often said. And so once we have these instructions and we practice them, then this half of our life also becomes spiritual training.
That is Jelia Trubadi Shamar Kunja Yala Tinalola Chu Yunginejo Dunjisunsha Karesana Nidi Zig Kaza de. Are chiga, chigegi, poa de zigzi, surduzi, poa de surduzi, and digel pardo de surduzi, dunchano. Tanging here should use an poa de pardoniam de zizer, which is a true mother of money. Diane poa de pardo guignam lendi, de zignam lend, gever which they shall. Mirim disuma which I shall do, chesa din de shumagoche. Diane congi yam lends, Yavachesan, tapaji dumetro.
Now, the next yoga, according to the sixth Shama Rinpoche's, actually there are seven of these yogas of the continual flow.
The fifth
Shama Rinpoche. There are seven of these yogas. After yoga, after yoga of sleep, there is the yoga at the time of death, and the yoga of the bardo. And so, putting these together, that makes seven different yogas. But as I said before, if you count the yogas of poa and the yoga of the bardo together, then that becomes six. Now the yogas of Poa and of the Bardo are actually quite long, and there are many visualizations to be done there. And so I think it's okay not to go through them today. In any case, if you do the practices I've already described well, then I think everything will work out just right. And now to go through the lineage of this practice, as it says in the instructions themselves. The lineage of Tsimbupa's direct instructions on the great compassionate one, Noble Avalokiteshvara, is Noble Avalokiteshvara, Vajrayogini, Mahasiddha Tsimbupa, Chithlepa, Takte Marwa, Hlatsung Gunsarwa, Gunpangpa, Gyawa Yeshe, Ketsung Yutung Gyatso, Chuje Kunchin Chenpo, Nyawun Kungapal, Nyawun Sunam Sambo, Kunchin Chambo Sampo, and Drupchen Tashi Paldur, who gave it to the great being who embodies all the wisdom, love, and deeds of all Buddhas of the three times, the unequaled, omniscient, glorious, great Karmapa Mikyo Dorje. The glorious guardian of existence and peace, the exalted, precious Lord, commanded me to write this down in this manner. So I have written it down without the slightest fault of making anything up. By this merit, may our minds be inseparable. Mikyo Dorje himself wrote the preliminaries, refuge, bodhicitta, and so forth. The field of accumulations, main practice, and Mahamudra were taken from Tropu Gyatso, the essence of which is based on the Mahasiddha Tsimbupa's instructions. Yung Chadawa took these notes, which were shown to Mikyo Dorje, so they can inspire confidence.
Dadi lama yurim di du sore chidangi chujin simbu balya loma dizugi tinjel loma dizugi da dangwan del gyuba yurim gyuba khanje yana skandi shubres dangwa jeresigi dangwan del ya gyuba khanje yana skandi shubres and de rizana kongi des go yurun jobo jinangares go yurun jobo da des
There's a story that when Lama Tsimbupa taught these instructions, these fifth instructions to his students, they then asked him, well, what is the lineage of these instructions? And when they asked him this, then Lama Nyen Tsimbupa scolded them a bit. He said, why are you asking about the lineage? You're asking about the lineage because you want to teach these instructions. That's the only reason you need to know what the lineage is. You want to teach them. So that's why you're asking about them. But I'm not, because, and you know, if you are teaching something, if you say, oh, this is the lineage of the instruction, it looks good, right? So Lama Tsimbupa said, my dharma isn't dharma for teaching. My dharma is dharma for practicing. This is the dharma that you need to practice it. And so he scolded them in this way when they asked him about the lineage. And so here I am teaching others this practice when I'm not able to practice it myself, and so it's like no choice for me but to go through the lineage of the instructions. But so as I said here, I described the other day that coming from Vajrayogini to Mahasiddha Tsenbupa, and I don't need to mention that again here. And then he gave it to Chihlepa, or Chiwolepa. Now, yesterday, or the other day, I said that Chiwolepa was his brother, but actually that was mistaken. His younger brother was actually someone named Chikbupa. And so the names are kind of similar, and so that's how I mixed them up. So Chiwolepa, or here he's called Chihlepa. Chiwolepa was one of his six disciples who received these instructions. And so this is the first of these six disciples, Chiwolepa Changchukwe.
He's the main disciple.
He's the primary disciple, Chiwolepa Changchukwe. The next one, Tate Drak Marwa, here saying Tate Drak Marwa, Tate Drak means the name of a region. And Drak Marwa is the name of a monastery. He was the Kempo or the abbot of this monastery, and his actual name was Changchub Sultram.
Adi jel lojun guen sarva shuadre. Lojun guen sarva sadi da guen sar saji gomba jevje. Di Kempo imra. Din di guen sar dene guen lojun guen sarva shuadre imra.
And so the next one is Hlatsen Gunsarwa. So Gunsar is the name, it seems to be the name of a monastery, and it seems he was the Kempo or abbot of this monastery, so that's why he's called here the Hlatsen or the venerable god or the venerable master Gunsarwa.
That is jela Gunbangba. Gunbangba di kongi dungru ne ba ji xiang yi ma zhe, xiang sa ruyu di xiang ji, xiang Gunbangba.
The next one is Kunpangba. So this is Shang Kunpangba. So Shang means the name of his clan, and he is responsible for spreading these instructions very widely. He spread them very widely. In fact, in the Jonang lineage, this is included among the four great instructions that they have, this instruction from Tsenbupa.
Shang Kunpangba ki dig dawa nasa di gyawa yisire da pa ji changsim gyawa yisi yisire drin ju sane changsim gyawa yisi nam yin ju sane 다 자석 여의 시대 아주 전환기 르 유난에 다 계심 십 자리 아래 다는 신기 공 당부 주진 뻑시기 까마 뻑시기 다 십지를 지내 수변을 수 수제 흉기 근데 십지 지내 나가래 근데 인류산에 다 이 자석 여의 시대 나가체
So Shankung Pampa, the reason that it, for this is because Shankung Pampa gave it to Gyawa Yeshe, and Gyawa Yeshe was one of the important figures in the lineage of Jonang Gurus. He was originally an attendant of the great Mahasiddha Karmapakchi. So this is Gyawa Yeshe.
That is Gyawa Yeshe. Kizuni Gazol, na, Kizuni Gazugi, Chuji Quinjin Chambosadi, Quinjin Chanamba Chambre, Quinjin Chanamba Chambu, Olia Nangne, that Nemach Nyangwen the Mangusundua, that Digi Shemoche, that Dine, Nyangwen Gunga Be, Nyangwen Sonam Sambu, that Digi Jambes Sambus, Anzu, Pankaran Jambes Sambu, Gamaba.
And so Ketsun Yunjatso gave it to Chuje Kenshin Chempo, and this refers to the great Jonang master, Jonang Chempo. And then we don't need to belabor the next few, the Nyawun Kunga Pal and the Nyawun Sunam Sampo. And then it was passed to the Kunchen Chambal Sampo. So Kunchen Chambal Sampo was one of the two primary gurus of the seventh Karmapa Chuje Jatso. And for this reason, he's included in the actual lineage or the true lineage of the Karma Kagyu. And from then on, it has been passed down in the Karma Kagyu tradition. Now here in this 20th Kagyu Gunchoe, we have invited for the first time a Kempo from the Jonang lineage to be one of the judges. And so during this occasion to also be able to teach a dharma that has been passed down from the great Jonang master, the Kunchen Jonang Chempo, I think is a really wonderful interconnection both in terms externally and internally. And so this completes the instructions on the direct instructions on the Great Compassionate One from Tsimbupa. We call these a direct instruction, but a direct instruction didn't really happen. A direct instruction should be really clear, but I didn't explain it either very clearly or very well. But in any case, we have concluded that this instruction. And so from tomorrow, we will have the teachings on the three essential points.
Ngakshaa
Now the three essential points are actually a little difficult. There's some very very thorny issues there. In particular, there's a lot about the view. There are a lot of refutations. In particular, there are refutations of Lord Tsongkhapa, the later middle way. So many refutations of this, and I have to think about how I'm actually going to explain this. It's not so nice to, not so good to always teach refutations when you're teaching the Dharma, but they're there, and so I have to think about how I will treat those. In any case, I will do my best to teach them.